I'd like you to just take a moment, and maybe if you could close your eyes. This is not going to be a meditation, but it's going to be a bit of an imagination. Imagine it's recess, and you're in second grade. And you walk out into recess, and you walk out onto the playground, and you see other children already playing. And games have already started. You're not quite in them yet. What are you thinking, and what are you feeling? Because that often evokes a lot of feelings in all of us. And if you want to just take a minute, less than a minute, 30 seconds, and turn to your neighbor and just share a little bit about what your thoughts or feelings are as you walk out onto that playground, it's often very diagnostic of how we see the world, right? What we call our working models of the world. So if you want to just have a little pair share for just 30 seconds or so, and share what it is that you experienced. So just to bring you back, if I can. Oops. Do I have the... I don't have the dinger. So how many of you experienced joy and excitement at the thought of that? Okay, some of you, not too many. How many experienced fear and trepidation and anxiety? Right? Yeah. So there's a lot of anxiety that children have when they're trying to work through these dynamics. And if I had given you a different one, which is going to a birthday party when you're in fifth grade and not sure if you should be there or not, you might have very different feelings. But there's a lot of emotions that come up, and the ability to regulate emotions around these contexts is really what this is all about. And I have to say this because my university makes me say this in every talk. So there you go. So what's the roadmap? What is compassion? Well, if I had a good answer for you, I would give it to you tonight. I'll try to give you a very partial answer from my perspective. We talk about compassion, kindness. We talk about pro-social behavior and empathy, altruism. Are these all the same thing? How does it or they develop? What do we know about the development of them? And then Maria asked me to talk about what can communities, schools, teachers, and parents do to nurture these qualities, okay? So I'm just the setup man tonight for everybody that's going to be speaking the next day or two, and hopefully I'll just hit some themes that will be important. And when I think about this, I think about how do we build resilience, and resilience is not just in the child but in the context. But I'm very interested in this issue, and it's interesting because when I came to British Columbia to work and study deaf children for the Children's Hospital, it was around the issue of attachment processes, and I'm an attachment theorist. And now I come back 35 years later to the same topic again, because healthy caring relationships with both peers and adults is really that's where it's at. But it requires good emotion regulation and self-control. It requires building attention, the ability to use attention effectively, and of course when we're thinking about schools, also learning capacity. But as kids get older, this sense of belonging and meaning is critical. Especially as we get into the early adolescent period, how children feel a sense of belonging and how they begin to make meaning of the world. You saw it in the dance tonight, the way that meaning was made of suffering. It's a very powerful sense of how to make meaning. But in addition, we think about the ecologies creating self-welcoming and caring schools and, of course, healthy, caring families. So that's sort of the context I think about this, and I found this on the web. I thought this was interesting because it had so many different kinds of dimensions of what compassion is, from the biobehavioral aspects of oxytocin to thinking about the behaviors that are part of this, thinking about heroism and people that illustrate compassion. Right? There's lots of ways that we think about what this word means. So as Holiness has talked about compassion a great deal, his new book, and for many, many years, And this is one definition that he's used, a sensitivity to the suffering and of self and others, with a deep commitment to try to relieve it. Okay? And that's what differentiates from it from empathy, where empathy is that deep sense of feeling what another feels, but not necessarily the commitment and the desire to relieve it coming with it. So we can think about compassion developing over time. From in infancy, what we just really call emotional contagion, and some of you might know the work of Tanya Singer. Really, anyone that's very interested in the developmental aspects of this, you might want to read some of her work or watch her videos. We move to empathy in the preschool years, one would probably say. And then the question is, when does true compassion come about? And I don't have an answer, but I'll raise some questions about it tonight. So we can think about the sort of Bronfenbrennerian idea that in the middle here, do I have a light? Not sure. In the middle here, we have what's called the microsystems of the child. And if you think about another dimension here, the chrono dimension of time, of course, it starts out mostly with the parent-child relationship. It then grows quickly towards childcare in our culture, and of course, maybe sibling interactions. It then broadens out to neighborhoods and to religious settings for many people. And these microsystems the child interacts with are going to be powerful in the development of these resiliency skills, including kindness and compassion. But then there's also the connection to the next level. That is, how it is that the family and the school, how our communities connect, how religious institutions connect, how the business world connects, and what kinds of interconnections happen that can facilitate cross-ecology support for children, to facilitate kindness and compassion and altruism. And then we can think about the exosystems, and then finally the dominant cultural beliefs. What are our cultural beliefs about what it means to be caring and compassionate, right? And we might have local cultural beliefs just in a neighborhood. We might have them in a school. We might have them for a city like Vancouver, which is known as a very compassionate city. But we might have them in a much broader sense in terms of what are our world or ideological beliefs. And then how does that translate into how we think about schools, how we legislate, what we think is important, what gets assessed, right? How it gets assessed, et cetera. So there's lots of levels at which to think about this problem or this issue. I think the Seattle Social Development Model is a great model to talk about how the skills are learned. Very simply, children have individual characteristics that we want to nurture, and we nurture them by bonding them, by building a high-quality, secure attachments to both parents, to teachers, to peers, and to communities. And we do that by providing opportunities and skills to children, right? Skills so they can learn new abilities, and these can be all kinds of skills. Once we teach them those skills, we need to give them real, genuine opportunities to use those skills. Not false ones, but it's more, we're not talking about role-playing here, but real opportunities to use those skills. And at least in childhood, we need to give them recognition for those skills, feedback and recognition. Now, I circled recognition because one of the real fundamental questions here from a conceptual standpoint is recognition necessary when one acts compassionately? Because when you really act from true compassion, at least we think that's the case, we do it just for itself and not for any recognition at all, right? When does that develop? When does one come to the point, this is not just an age but a personal development, where the desire to be compassionate is so powerful that it's no longer based at all on recognition, even self-recognition, right? It's just the way one is. And so this begins with starting with healthy beliefs. What are the healthy dominant cultural beliefs that are forwarding down, that are coming down to what skills and opportunities, what skills we teach, what opportunities we provide, what recognition we give? So there's this dominant cultural sense of what are healthy behaviors? What is it we prize most, right? And then how do we go about inculcating these in children by building a commitment and attachment that leads them to those skills? So there's a lot of contextual issues that support kindness and compassion. Just a couple are early childhood attachments to parents and caregivers, and I'm going to spend some time on that tonight. What children see adults do and why. We know from psychology for a long time that it's what adults do and not what they say, right? But it's not just what they do, it's how they make meaning of what they do, right? So how we talk to children about what we're doing and why we're doing it is critically important. What values are promoted at home, at school, in the community? These are important. And what does it mean to have a value? So when a school says it's a school of compassion, what does that mean? Is it really living out that value? And what skills children learn and what skills they have the opportunity to practice are going to be important. And this is not just going to be at school, it's going to be in the neighborhood, and it's going to be in the Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts, and it's going to be in after-school programs, and it's going to be in summer camps. All throughout the child's ecology, what skills are we providing them with, and what opportunities are we giving them to practice? Because practice is what makes it happen. So it begins with parenting, it really begins with attachment theory, I think. And I was a student of Mary Ainsworth, so you can date me now, if you will. and I also knew John Bowlby and worked a bit with him. And attachment theory began with the problem of maternal deprivation originally, but when Mary Ainsworth began to study children, by the way, she's Canadian. You notice that? Born in Toronto, did her PhD at the University of Toronto, what she began to do is actually study how it is that attachments develop in babies. And she did that both in Africa and in the United States. And what she basically found was that attachments are a close emotional bond, of course, but they have this important focus, which is how they protect the child. The biological function is really to keep the child protected. And we can see individual differences already. They're very clear by 12 months of age. They aren't necessarily stable. They don't necessarily mark a person for life at 12 months of age. There's lots of flexibility in the attachment system over time. But we know that children who are securely attached early are much more likely to have certain characteristics later, given that they have a good continuity in their development. And attachments are not just about babies. They're cradle to grave. Our attachments are affecting us all the time. And our working model of the world is changed by how we're loved and how we love others. So what happens over time is that infants have attachment experiences with their parents, and from that they begin to develop a cognitive model, what attachment theorists call the internal working model, of how lovable they are and how well they'll be cared for by others. And this is constructed over time, not just by their relationship with their mother or just by their father, but it becomes generalized over time to a sense of how well they'll be cared for and how much value they have. And you can see that the children that have a more secure relationship, and this is all relative, okay? I'm not getting into absolutes here, are more likely to feel they'll be loved and cared for. Children that have more of an avoidant relationship, it's about 20% of children in a typical society, will often feel unloved and rejected. And it's also shown in their behavior and their physiology. And resistant children are often come out being angry and confused. Okay? If I can just generalize and stereotype these three groups of kids. But it's not just children that we can characterize this way. So what's happening across early development is secure attachment creates what Dan Siegel calls interpersonal attunement, the ability to be attuned with others. And when that happens, we get better internal self-regulation. And when that happens, we become more resilient to the suffering that we all face. So we get from mutual regulation, where a parent or the caregiver is helping to mutually regulate the baby, to the preschooler that begins to become regulated by themselves, that begin to have internal self-regulation. But we can think about this happening again in adolescence, right? Oftentimes, adolescence is called the second separation individuation crisis. We're now at a new level, and many of you who are parents of adolescents know this well, that the issue of mutual regulation comes back in a new way again, and there's an unstable sense of self-regulation, again, in adolescence. So what are the consequences of attachment quality? Just very simply, there's a number of them. We know that even in the early years, just in the preschool years and toddlerhood, that children that are more secure are more positive in their relationships. They show more empathy. They're less aggressive. They're more likely to make positive friendships. In childhood, we know that they're better at understanding their emotions. They have better emotional awareness. They're also likely to see things that are that are happened by accident as not being hostile, whereas children that are insecure are more likely to right away assume hostile intent when something happens by accident. They have a chip on their shoulder cognitively, if you will. Even at age 11, we see that children who are secure as babies are more likely to be confident, to be competent, to have higher self-esteem. But we also know across development that many children change classifications due to all kinds of circumstances. So I'm not saying that what happens in infancy is determinative, but it is powerful. But children are pushing us into the next stage of development. Any of you who are parents know that you struggle as children push you into the next stage, at every stage in development. And we can think about this ideal progression from being secure in infancy in your attachments to becoming good in your peer relations, having healthy peer relations in childhood, to moving towards intimate friendships, what Harry Stack Sullivan would say is the essential component of adolescence, and into healthy romantic relationships in adulthood, making good choices. Now that's what I call an ideal progression. Very few of us in this room probably had the gift of that ideal progression and that environment that held us, if you will, across all of development. And then we can think about this as going into adulthood. And there is a fair amount of research now, and I'm going to talk about some of it, showing that people who are secure in their attachments not only show better friendship and intimacy and respect as they grow, but as they become older, they're more likely to be altruistic. They show more cooperation and caring and compassion. Okay? And I'm going to illustrate this through work of Mario Melsolkner and Phil Shaver. Mario is in Israel, Phil is in California. They've done a series of very interesting studies on adult attachment and compassion. I don't know if any of you are familiar with these. I'm going to go through them sort of quickly, but to give you a sense of this. So there's a theory here that is based on what I've already said, that people who have a sense of attachment security are probably more likely to be able to focus on the suffering of others. And when they feel the suffering of others, to activate systems of caregiving rather than self-protective avoidance or anxiety. Okay? And because of their security of their attachments, they're more likely to open themselves up to unfamiliar others and to consider the point of views of others, other point of views rather than their own. They're able to move out of their own point of view. This was the theory that they tested. And first they did some surveys in Holland, the United States, and Israel. And what they found is that compared to people who in adulthood identify themselves as secure, avoidant people volunteered less. And when they did volunteer, they did it for reasons that were less generous. Okay? They were more likely to do it, suggesting a lack of compassion or generosity. Instead, they showed less gratitude, and they were also less forgiving of others. Compared to secure people, anxious people didn't volunteer less than secure ones. But they were less forgiving, and they got involved in volunteering for more security-enhancing reasons. Right? As the reasons behind this, which I think are very important to compassion, were different. They was to feel included, to feel appreciated, to get recognition. Okay? Still wanting to have recognition for what one does. Now, they then did a series of studies in which they experimentally primed security. This is social psychologists. And the way they did that is they did it either unconsciously, that subliminally where you couldn't see it, it's too fast to actually see, but you're unconsciously seeing the words. They primed the names of supportive attachment figures for people. Or by conscious priming, they asked people to think about specific examples of being comforted or being taken care of. So if I did this with you tonight and I had you think about people people that have taken care of you or have comforted you, they then asked participants to help a suffering woman by taking her place in a laboratory situation, stressful laboratory situation. In reality, of course, she was an actress. And what they found was, right here, as you can see, those that were primed with a security prime, that is to think about being cared for and being loved, et cetera, had a much, much higher percentage of being able to actually not just say they would do something, but they actually volunteered to put themselves in the place of the woman who was in this stressful situation and who was suffering. Okay? So just being primed, doesn't matter if we might think we're avoidant, or we think we're anxious, or we think we're secure, for anyone who is primed in that situation, it led them to become more compassionate and to relieve the suffering of another. Well, this also relates to in-group and out-group attitudes. In another study they did with secular Jewish university students in Israel, what they did is they had them imagine being optimally supported and cared for. Again, that imagination of a cared for situation. Or they primed them with using words such as love, hug, secure, that were presented subliminally. In both these situations, they then had participants assess their feelings towards a variety of what you might call outgroups. And you can see those there, Arabs, ultra-Orthodox Jews, Russian immigrants, and homosexuals. The results were, when they were primed, it eliminated the difference between their in-group and their out-group perceptions. Just having those priming experiences, very short term, influence how they thought about in-group versus out-group. It basically eliminated the difference. But if you did the same priming, but used different words like success or happy, there was no effect. Okay? So being primed for these words that have to do with relationship, right, and with being cared for and loved, has a powerful effect on us even in the very short term. Security priming also increased two what we call transcendent values. One was benevolence, being loved and kind towards people that are close to you, but also what they called universalism, which is understanding and appreciating and tolerating and wanting to protect all people. Okay? Security priming didn't interact with the attachment style that people started with. That is, in that sense, it suggests that everyone's sense of security can be enhanced with beneficial effects on tolerance and compassion. So what we feed is what we get, you see? And this is a very simple experiment on how in a very short term, in a laboratory situation, we can change people's sense of themselves and others. So in summary, avoidant people, were less likely to show compassion and less willing to help others. Anxious people became more distressed, as you might expect in the situation, but it didn't increase their compassion or their altruism. The fact that they became more distressed is often what happens in compassion fatigue or over-identifying in an empathic way in a situation, right? It makes you feel distressed, but it doesn't necessarily help you relieve the suffering of others. So even dispositionally insecure people, though, became more compassionate and altruistic when they had these primes for feeling more secure, okay? So this tells us something, I think, really important about what things we might be doing in our communities, in our schools, in our families. Now, there's a connection between all this that John Bowlby started to talk about, that Dan Siegel talks about a lot, and that Shaver and Molsoner also do, and that is attachments are regulatory. That's why they're important. They're not important for themselves, well, they are for protection, but because its attachment relationships shape the regulatory circuits of the brain, okay, in a very broad sense. And a secure mind, as many of you probably have heard Dan Siegel talk about before, is a mind that's more reflective. And it's more reflective because it's less focused on protecting itself in every moment of action. Okay? And that reflection enables one to grow in social and emotional intelligence. Okay? It's at the heart of mindfulness. And so it's likely that the common root of secure attachment, empathy, and compassion, these are all working together. Security, mindfulness, empathy, compassion. Because when one feels settled in oneself and unconsciously secure, one is able to reach out more to others. So there's a strong connection, I think, between attachments and the way we promote and facilitate attachments, not just in infants, but across our lifespan, across all kinds of our relationships, and how likely we are to become compassionate. So, just a question here. Are these priming experiments similar to practices of loving kindness we often see in meditation practices? By bringing one's mind to the sense of feeling love and joy and caring, and then extending that to others, can we increase children's and adults' sense of connectedness, right, of altruism, of caring? Okay? Because these priming experiments are really quite similar to some of the major mindfulness practices, for example, the benefactor practice. And if so, then how do we do this in the right ways at different ages, in ways that are thoughtful and careful? Okay? So is it mindfulness practices? Is self-compassion practice, which many of you probably know about, an important one? There's the benefactor and loving kindness practices. These often come from Buddhist roots in Lojong and Tonglen practices. But there's other ways we can do this. Storytelling is a great way to prime, I think, prime these abilities, these attitudes and emotions. So one of the questions that you have to come to sooner or later when you think about the developmental issues here is cultivating self-compassion a necessary step to be compassionate? Okay? This is a quote from Rabbi Roth. He says, it's important to cultivate compassion for our own humanity. When our hearts open to our own suffering, we begin to also be more accepting of others and to realize that they too have the same struggles. Okay? And this is a theme that we hear all the time, is that one needs to turn compassion toward the self in order to also then give to others. Okay? How does this develop? I don't think we have hardly any sense of how this develops at this point. Pema Chodron said this really well, I think. She said, as we learn to have compassion for others, the circle of compassion for ourselves, the circle of compassion for others, what and whom we can work with and how becomes wider. Okay? Same kind of theme, that by being gentle and kind and compassionate with the self, right, instead of having that critical working model, which you probably many of you had when you thought about walking out on the playground. How are people going to be nice to me? Right? Am I going to be able to join a group? Will I be all alone on the playground? Do kids like me? Etc. Right? All those fearful working model thoughts that come up, that's the nature of mind, right? How do we build, in a sense, how do we support, facilitate self-compassion? So, because when you're in that state of worry and anxiety, you're not likely to be very good at reaching out to others or even making good relationships, right? So another couple questions made me think about given this talk. When a child shows compassion, should we consider it to be different than what's shown or experienced by a teen or an adult? Should we call it the same thing? Is it the same thing? So when you see a second grader help another in distress, is it the same thing as seeing an adult behave compassionately, right? Because for the child, we would call this intuitive. They don't have this metacognitive ability where they're thinking in a way we might think about compassion as adults, right? Because they don't have that thought structure yet. They don't have the metacognitive understanding of the relationships of a sense of oneness, right? And the sense of transcendence, or the sense that there's relations between all living beings, right? We might have told them that, they might be able to repeat it back to us, but I don't think they have that metacognitive ability yet. So should we talk about it differently? Is it the same thing? I don't have an answer. I'm posing the questions. If children are insecure in their attachments, let's go back to attachments, where they've experienced a lot of trauma, does that mean that we need to do more work in the area of self-compassion before we have them try to do compassionate acts? Because if it's true that there's a relationship here between security or insecurity and the ability to be empathic and compassionate, then do we have to help children by really helping them become much more comfortable in caring about themselves first? Right? Which is what the rabbi said, it's what Pema said. But we don't have any good developmental research on this at all, right? No one's ever looked at security of children, for example, and then looked at different practices and how they might operate. Or looking at children that have trauma and don't have trauma, and what would be the best ways to begin to help them become more compassionate. So there's a bigger picture here, and this will date me because the Atman Project, I think I read in the 70s by Ken Wilber. But Ken Wilber is a person who thinks about this a lot, the bigger picture of the comprehensive models of the development of behavior and consciousness. Began with the Atman Project and many other books. If anyone really understands a brief history of everything, they can tutor me after the session. But because Ken Wilber is hard to understand, there is now Ken Wilber for Dummies. But I would say to you that if you're really interested in thinking developmentally in a very broad multicultural way about this, that his thinking is important. And he has these very complex models of the many stages from infancy and egocentrism all the way to transcendence and realization. So he takes Western and Eastern theories and meta-theories of psychology and introduces them into one big model. And so you can just think about the column of age and thinking about how age occurs and Piaget's ideas about being pre-operational and then concrete in your thinking and then metacognitive, and thinking about how you become, you start out as egocentric, of course, and you become more sociocentric, and then you may become world-centric, and then you develop past that. Or what Ken called moving from pre-personal to personal, developing a healthy ego, to becoming transpersonal, to leaving the ego behind and the needs behind, and being compassionate just because it's what you do, not because of recognition or anything else. So without spending more time on Ken tonight, I think that people who are really interested in these developmental theories of how Freud and Maslow and Jung fit with Eastern models of thought and consciousness, he's the person to read. He talks about compassion, and I put this quote up because I want us to think a little bit about what compassion really is. Chogyam Trungpa Rinpoche often talked about what he called idiot compassion. And this is a quote by Ken. He said, idiot compassion thinks it's being kind, but it's really being cruel. If you have an alcoholic friend and you know that one more drink might kill him, and yet he begs you to give him one more drink, does real compassion say that you should give it to him? After all, to be kind, you should give him what he wants, right? Giving him the drink would therefore show compassion, yes? And Ken says, no, absolutely not. Because real compassion includes wisdom, and so it makes judgments of care and concerns discriminative. It says some things are good, there's an ethics to this, and some things are bad. And I will choose to act only on the things that are informed by wisdom and care. Okay? So being kind is not the same thing as being compassionate. Because we might think it was a very kind thing to let that person have a drink. Right? But it isn't acting with wisdom and discrimination. So compassion and kindness, we use these words, altruism, charity. We often use these words together. But there's something very specific about acting with compassion that has a sense of a strong ethical background that makes it differentiated. And of course, we know from the work of Tanya Singer that we see different neural substrates active in compassion than, for example, in empathy. So now, translating this all to schools, how do we create schools that lead to the highest levels of creativity and caring, compassion? And I want to bring into the room a dear friend of mine who was my mentor in thinking about this when I was still resistant to thinking about it, and that's Rachel Kessler. She wrote the incredible book I think it was 2000, called The Soul of Education. And if you're interested in thinking deeply about what the mystery of learning is and what it means to have soul in education, I would really recommend you try to get this book. It's really the guide. So Rachel had a vision, which she wrote in the book. She said, imagine if every student were provided with a safe place to sit with a small group of peers and reflect on their lives, okay? To share the questions that trouble or confuse and mystify them, to find support for their pain and joy, discover the solace that comes in silence, and to be challenged to respect those who appear fundamentally different from them, right? That's what we want. We want schools that allow that kind of process. She said, making such experiences available not only nourish students' spiritual development, but it helps them to transcend prejudice, to increase their motivation to learn, to improve focus and cooperation. In other words, caring about the inner lives of our students makes educational sense at every level. Now, I know I'm talking to the converted in many ways, but this is essential. This is what would be called bringing in the inner life into schools. Okay? And just a few more quotes from her. I use the term soul to call attention in schools to the inner life, to the depth dimension of human experience, to students longing for more than ordinary material and fragmented existence, which is often what we give them. When the soul is present, attention shifts. We listen with great care. And when we concentrate on what has heart and meaning, the yearning, wonder, wisdom, fear, and confusion of students becomes central to the curriculum. Okay? It becomes the center of the curriculum, right? Now, Castle has been thinking about this for a long time, and you've seen the Castle 5 probably if you've been to any heart-mind meeting of any kind. But I think there's a way in which contemplative practices of different kinds, I don't mean necessarily yoga or meditation, it could be storytelling, or it could be service learning, it could be actively witnessing things, it can be Japanese calligraphy, there's many, many ways of being contemplative. Well, I think that contemplative practices can deepen these five quadrants of SEL. So in terms of self-awareness, right, which we talk about children becoming aware of their emotions and their values, as they get older, contemplative practices can help them understand the nature of mind, right? As we saw up here in the dance tonight, right? The notion of what it means to suffer and what it means to have joy at the same time, right? Understanding the fleeting nature of mind. In terms of self-management, I think the contemplative practices are very useful in helping children to better deploy their attention, to become more emotionally regulated, and to show more self-control or inhibitory control. In terms of social awareness, contemplative practices, especially those that are active, that help children to become out in the world. I'm not talking about sitting on a pillow or watching your breath. I'm talking about active practices. Can help children show empathy and compassion for others. And in the area of relationship skills, helping to form relationships, et cetera, I think contemplative practices can help children to really learn to listen in a different way. And it's listening that most all of us, including myself, are probably worst at. We know what we want to say, but we don't know how to listen, right? And listening is a critical skill that often is not taught and not learned. And when you don't have good listening, you don't have real dialogue, what we would call thoughtful dialogue. And we're not able to manage conflict very well because we're still in our own state of mind too much. And then lastly, we talk in Castle about responsible decision-making or problem-solving. But in the contemplative practice, we often talk about stating facts without judgment. Right? It's a deeper sense of what that means to do, and making ethical choices based on awareness and caring. So I just gave you the example of idiot compassion. Right? What does it mean to act truly with compassion in a situation? Now, that's not something we're going to teach four-year-olds, but it might be something we teach 14-year-olds, right? And we teach it by learning from them, not just through didactic work. Now, Castle has a model of all this, and that is we want to have two things. We want to teach these five kinds of skills, and we can teach them in many different ways, lots of ways to do that. But in addition, we have to have safe, caring, well-managed schools, right? And to do that, we have to have not just evidence-based programming, we have to have teachers who are aware of themselves, are aware of their own social-emotional abilities and needs, and are able to deliver a safe, care, and well-managed environment in a truly genuine way, and support the development of these skills in very genuine ways, where they model these skills as well, they embody them. And when we do that, we know that children will have greater attachment to school. There's good evidence of this. They're less likely to be involved in risky behavior and have more positive development, and therefore they're likely to do better. The best predictor, as you know, of adult health and adult labor market outcomes is not the cognitive skills, it's what we're called the non-cognitive skills, right? So we know SEL is acquired through caring environments. Caring environments are important. We don't teach parents how to help their children become secure usually. It just happens naturally in good situations. But we talk about having sequenced, active, and focused SEL programming, developmentally and culturally competent strategies and helping children to become reflective, and opportunities to contribute. This is really important for the compassion part of this, opportunities to contribute to their class, to their school, and their community. Oops. So underlying all of this, what attachments do is attachments help us regulate our emotions in ways that we can manage emotions in a way that keeps our attention open and focused so we can see the environment more truly as it is, if you will, because we're not clouded so much by anxiety or other kinds of factors. And emotion regulation is really the key skill here. People that regulate their emotions well are much more likely to have all the positive attributes we want. And we can improve these emotion regulation skills through the use of social emotional learning programs. It's really the bedrock of human development. And these predict adult labor market outcomes. And I'm not really going to talk about research much tonight, but I'll just give you a little study that I've been involved in for 25 years, which involves what's called the Fast Track Project. It's a study of 1,000 children living in very, very high crime, high risk neighborhoods in four American locations. And we've been studying them since they were 5.5 years of age, and now they're in their late 20s. And we wanted to ask the question, do teachers' ratings, just the teacher rating of children's social and emotional competence in grade one predict young adult outcomes? Okay? This is a complicated question. It sounds like a simple question. It turns out it's really complicated. And by social emotional competence, we're talking about two things. One is their ability to regulate their emotions and have self-control, and their ability to get along well with their friends. Those are really the two skills. So to do this, we had to control for all kinds of other things that might be also related to adult labor market outcomes. And since we knew these families in great depth, we had a lot of data on them. So we controlled for things like their gender, because that might affect their adult outcomes, their socioeconomic status. Many of our families were in poverty. Their race, ethnicity, if their parent was a teen when they were born. Ratings of the quality of the home environment. So we visited all of these homes regularly, and we rated the quality of the home environments. So we're trying to get rid of all these other factors. Their kindergarten reading ability, their early intelligence, and the kindergarten rating of aggression, and the first grade rating of aggression. So we're trying to get all those out of the picture, because aggression, people who are aggressive are probably going to have poorer labor market outcomes. People with lower IQs are probably going to have poorer labor market outcomes, right? So we wanted to remove all those in a complex, what we call a causal analysis. And what we found is after controlling for all those variables, what we found is children as rated in their social emotional competence in first grade, just a simple rating, 10 items, 12 items by a teacher, predicted the rate of high school graduation, the number of years they were in special education through high school. Again, remember, controlling for IQ and social status and everything else. The number of years they were on medication through high school, their age 25 employment earnings, their age 25 stability of employment, their self-reports of how many times they were arrested and had police contacts, and their amount of time in jail by the time they were 25. Right? And remember, this is controlling for how aggressive they were by two different years of ratings, the quality of their home environments, and everything else. Okay? What this means is that it doesn't mean that what happens in first grade is determinative. I don't mean it that way. But it means that children's early social-emotional regulation is carrying through all the way into their adulthood. Right? And therefore, how much we care about this is not just a matter of us being nice or wanting children to be compassionate. It has to do with the fabric of our society. What is it? What kind of society are we trying to develop? So I just was in a meeting in Banff about bullying. I get upset about all the bullying focus. And so I want to talk about this a little bit because the political narrative in everywhere, I'm sure it's the same in BC, it's all over Canada, United States, England, Japan, Norway, it doesn't matter where it is, it's all about bullying. Bullying is a very simple thing for everybody to be against. How many people in this room were not bullied? Okay, so we have maybe four people in this room that have never been bullied. So because everybody's been bullied pretty much, everybody can identify this, and any politician can stand up and say, I want to stop bullying, right? It doesn't matter if they're on the right or the left or the middle. It's politically safe. It's great politics, right? And they're willing to put money out to create bullying campaigns and to stop bullying, right? But this is not where we want to be as a society. We're not trying to stop bullying. We're trying to build a bedrock of healthy human development, right? And that's different than stopping bullying or stopping violence. I mean, bullying is a very limited aspect of violence anyway. We want to stop the narrative. We want the narrative to not be preventing bullying, but instead building caring, healthy schools. We want to stop from convincing children that bullying is bad. They all know it already, of course. To teaching skills and creating conditions that provide rewarding pro-social relationships. Right? We've got to stop this narrative. It's an unhealthy, it's a damaging narrative. We want to create norms with teachers and students and parents that are focused on the kindness and altruism and caring, not on stopping bullying. Right? And we don't want to stop things, we want to build things. We want to be proactive, we want to be comprehensive, and we want to be developmental. And so whenever we hear this bullying narrative, we have to be really careful not to just let it go, right? I'm not against the idea of stopping bullying. Does anybody in this room want to not stop bullying? But is that our goal? Right? Our goal is building healthy human development by building a caring society that's evidenced in parenting, it's evidenced in the way our schools work, it's the way our institutions work. And much of this is based on fundamental ideas that are in every society. Right? You know the Charter for Compassion that's been active in Vancouver? The idea of the Golden Rule is across almost every single religious and some non-religious traditions. Right? It's the basis of much of my work. And there are three components of change here, I think, that are important. Whenever we want to create a healthy set of norms and a healthy, caring school, we want to have skills and practices. Right? And those are for both adults and for children. We want to have a worldview or an orientation. Some of you as Buddhists might call it a dharma. Right? In church, it's a homily. Right? In a synagogue, it's a sermon. And we want to have a community that holds us together. Right? Those are the three things when we think about what makes a healthy cultural context. It could be a school, it could be a family, it could be a neighborhood. And we have skills and practices that we use and we support in children and young adults. We have a worldview that makes meaning of those skills and values, and we have a community that holds them together. This is, looks very similar to what the Buddha said. The Buddha said there's the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. Right? Same idea. It's true in every religion. In PATHS, in my work for the last 34 years, that's been our goal. So when we think about what we do from preschool all the way to grade 6, we talk about it as living the Golden Rule, and we actually introduce Golden Rule lessons at different grade levels. Because fundamentally, if kids can do this, if they can really operate as children by that Golden Rule, they're likely to do very well. And this, to us, includes then these kinds of skills, having awareness of emotional states, being able to put feelings into words, very powerful for children, the ability to become calm when feeling highly aroused, the ability to plan ahead and think about others, and the development of empathy and compassion. And we've shown, just in our work, that that both children and adults need these skills. SEL programs show that the effects of this, for example, in PATHS, we have improved emotional understanding and expression, randomized trials in three different countries now on improved executive functions. That's hip these days, although I don't know how important it is. Reduced aggression and disruptive behavior. Improve positive, caring relationships by not adults' reports, but by children's own reports of how caring the children in their classes are, and greater engagement and attention. When we teach these skills, they're master bedrock skills of human development. Lots of other things follow. And there are other SEL curriculums that have similar evidence that focus on caring. Some of you, many of you are using MindUp. How many MindUp users do we have in the room? Great. RCCP and 4Rs. Learning to Breathe is a high school program. The Responsive Classroom, Caring School Community, Roots of Empathy, another Canadian program. The work down in Emory on cognitive-based compassion training. These are just examples, right? And these are all great ideas. PATHS is a great idea. MindUp's a great idea. These are all great ideas. But how that we do them in the school is important. So we have to think not just about the curriculum, but we have to think about what it means to create a caring school. And that means both children and adults need emotion regulation skills. Many times adults need them even more than children. Right? Teachers and parents need to create healthy norms and a safe environment where children really truly feel safe. And schools and communities need to adopt practices that create shared communities of caring, of practice caring, not just talking about it. This can include high-quality SEL skills, mindfulness skills, expressing caring, expressing compassion, expressing gratitude. Those kinds of things are important. And this requires great principal leadership. Right? If there's one thing I learned in 34 years of implementing in now over 3,000 schools in about 25 countries is that the one common denominator that makes this work or not work is the principal's leadership. Right? So if that's the case, we need to think about how we educate our leaders, if you will, in order to make this work. Tom Boyce, who's in the audience, I think has written recently about what he calls learner-centered pedagogical practices to create healthy school environments. I think this is important. It's not just SEL programs or evidence-based models. It's how the teacher has a pedagogy. And Tom, if I've got this right, this kind of pedagogy encourages students to actively contribute to decisions and what goes on in the classroom. They respect and support children's unique cultural and developmental issues. The teachers value interacting in a really egalitarian way, so they're co-creating learning with their students. And Tom has shown that these practices then protect children that are already low in sociometric status, that are seen negatively by their peers. Shelley Hemel, is Shelley here tonight? No. She talks about we need to create a we-ness in schools that creates solidarity and similarity rather than difference. And what our schools are really good is at creating difference rather than solidarity. So schools can adopt practices that just create this shared community of caring. It's possible to nurture these issues. I think Kim will talk about some of this, and so will other people in the next day or two. But there's a process here we need to think about. We want to teach skills, back to the social development model. We want to provide ample and genuine opportunities to practice the skills in lots of contexts. And we want to provide feedback and recognition for their performance in childhood. So how do schools and communities do this, right? Well, if I had another hour or two, I might tell you. But we need to think about what are the roles of community agencies and groups, and how are they linked to schools? Because schools are really the critical social context that we have. How do we create strong elder-child ties, for example? The importance of elders and children to create compassion at both ends of the lifespan. So for example, I've seen some wonderful examples of putting child care centers in nursing homes and independent living centers. How do we create contexts in which people come together in a way that allows both ends to be compassionate? What's the role of reflective service learning and volunteering? Right? So some states in America, I don't know if you have this in the provinces, require children to have a service learning experience before they finish high school. But most kids think it's a joke because it's not a reflective, deep experience. But how do we make these deep experiences? How is ecological literacy, Dan will be here on Saturday, how is ecological literacy, how is understanding the nature of our ecology relate to cultivating compassion for all beings? By deeply understanding how it is that ecologies work, how every aspect of an ecology affects other aspects, right? We can do this in science. We don't have to just do this in language arts or in social studies. So at Penn State, I've been involved with a great group of people called PEACE, Promoting Empathy, Awareness, and Compassion Education. And we've been thinking about this for about the last decade or so, doing all kinds of randomized trials and different kinds of studies on mindfulness for teachers, mindfulness for parents, and mindfulness programs for youth. And I think we're still at the very beginning of this, and we want to not have hubris that we know that everything works. But instead that we think deeply about what we've learned so far so we get better at this, okay? So I learned this process in PAS in 1980. I and a couple of graduate students started with the PAS curriculum. And we were so self-satisfied that we got results, where the control group looked worse than the intervention group, because it got PAS. But we shouldn't be satisfied with significant group differences. Right? That's not our goal. Our goal is not to just show that one intervention or one curriculum is better than another curriculum. Our goal is to embed deeply these curriculums into the context of schools in a way that really builds the kinds of communities we want to have. And there's much to be learned about mindfulness with children. We don't know hardly anything at all. There's the first two studies that even have a follow-up, even of 6 months, of studying the effect of mindfulness were just published in the last year. So a year ago, there wasn't one study in the world that showed that mindfulness training for children had any effect a year later, 6 months later, a year later, 2 years later. We don't have any data on that. If you believe that we do, you've been misinformed. Okay? There may be effects, and they may last, or they may be short term. Okay? We really don't know. We don't know much about this yet. But we do know that helping adults to become mindful is really essential. And if there's one place I would put my bet, if I was a superintendent, and there was one place I would spend my funds, it would be on building the social-emotional capacities and the caring and nurturing of teachers, right? Not that programs for children are not important, but I think we have to think about what's essential. And we've been thinking about this a lot for the last decade. We've been thinking about what are these interpersonal aspects of mindfulness that we want to promote, especially in teachers and in parents, how to listen fully and deeply, how to be present-centered in our awareness, something very difficult. These two things are difficult for any adult, right? As Oscar Wilde said, he said, only the naive know themselves, right? That is, our social-emotional development never ends. We're always struggling to become more aware and to have a better fidelity and match between our thoughts and our emotions and our behavior. Being open and non-judgmental and receptive to children. Being low in reactivity and low in automaticity, so we're more self-regulated. And having compassion for ourselves, that how difficult all those things are to do, they're almost impossible. And having compassion for our students, because they even have more difficulty doing this given their developmental phase. So we believe that working with the adults is the essential component. And that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be doing programs with kids, but I think we need to reverse our emphasis. And we're not there yet. Now, there are a lot of resources for learning more about all this. And of course, the Dalai Lama Center for Peace and Education is number one. But I think Greater Good, for those of you that know this, is a very useful resource. And so is Random Acts of Kindness Foundation. And someone told me that we have Random Acts of Kindness people here tonight. Very good. Thank you. Didn't know you were here. So this was unintended to make you feel good. So there's a vision, I think, of social-emotional learning for classrooms, for schools, for nations and for the world. This is Castle's vision from even 10 years ago. And that is educators, students, families, and community members work together to support the healthy development of all children. Do we have schools that do that yet? Where all schools are engaged, students are engaged as active learners who are self-aware, caring, respectful, connected to others, responsible decision makers, and academic achievers, and where students are contributing in positive ways to their schools and to their communities. Right? That's the vision of what we want. There may be places in BC, I think, that are already getting very close to this, or maybe already there, but we really have very few schools in the world, and I travel a lot, in which I could say that we're even close. So think about this as a vision for what we take away from this weekend. Is how do we get there, right? What are all the components with teachers, with children, with the context of the school and the neighborhood, with the way we interact with families, et cetera, that can do this? And I'm going to close with a quote by Marion Wright Edelman, which I think is about joining together for this common goal. She said, "I was taught that the world had a lot of problems," and that's reflected in the discussion of our president of the Dalai Lama Foundation, "that I could struggle and I could change them, that intellectual and material gifts brought the privilege and the responsibility of sharing with others less fortunate. And that service," I love this line, "service is the rent each of us pay for living. It is the very purpose of our lives." And since most of you are teachers, we're all caregivers, aren't we? We see this as the service of our life. We're not there just to help children learn math and language arts and to pass the provincial tests. We're there because our heart is in this work, because we see it as she says, service is the rent each of us pays for living, right? For our opportunities to be on this earth in a way that allows us to really give our best hopes and dreams into reality by the compassionate behavior and the caring we show to others. So with that, I'll close. I think I'm over by a minute or two. And remember, keep calm and connect your body and your mind, because that's where all this is at. And thank you.